Depression is like something's sucking the life out of you. Like you lose all your motivation, you lose all your aspirations, your dreams, your goals. They might still be there in the back of your mind, but you've kind of lost touch with them. It's like, I wouldn't say it's like they're unattainable in your mind, but it's like, it feels like even if you reach them goals, it won't make you happy. So you lose the motivation to go and do them. Because what's the point if it's not going to make you happy? You know, I just want to lock myself away. I think the biggest effect depression had on me, apart from me losing motivation to do stuff, is it had a physical effect on me. I completely lost all energy. I had no energy. I mean, some days I'd barely be able to walk upstairs. I was that tired. All I'd want to do is sleep. I'd be in work and my eyes would be going. I'd go home and I'd just go straight to bed. I felt groggy and down and horrible all the time. And I couldn't pick myself up out of it. And you try and justify it. You know, you try and think, oh, I'll sort myself out. I'll start eating right. I'll start going to bed early. I'll do it from Monday. Monday's the best day to do it on. And it was always planning to do it in the future because I just didn't have the strength to do it now. And that's what depression does. It takes over. It just takes over and you walk around with this dark cloud over your head all the time. And no matter how sunny it actually is in real life, that dark cloud's blocking it and you can't get past it. Can't get past it.
Right, so it's 5 o'clock, Friday. I've not long got home from work. Got no plans for the weekend. And I just can't be arsed. I just feel tired. And I don't want to go out. Kind of feel guilty about it because I feel like I should be going out and doing something, but whenever you think about something that I could go and do, I've just got no motivation. The only thing that appeals to me right now is either going to sleep or staying in this room and watching films all night. Kind of escaping, you know, and I'll probably end up doing this all weekend until I go back to work on Monday. Come home from work on Monday and just do this again. It's mad because I want to go out and do stuff. I feel like I should, but can't do it. The mind's willing, but it's like the mind split into two. Part of it's willing and wanting to do that and telling you should, and the other half saying, but you can't. I'd really love to go. I went to a place last year called Conway Falls. It's a waterfall in Wales, and I love waterfalls and all that. I find it dead peaceful. And I went there with my then girlfriend and it was an amazing place, but I wasn't able to appreciate it for what it was because it's like your mind's numb to things. And I thought a lot about trying to go back, but just can't do it. Getting the motivation to go and do it, isn't there? It'd be amazing just to go there and not feel like I feel, and just take it all in. And just be really aware of it all and feel at peace. And who knows, maybe one day. But not today.
I used to think I had everything. You know, I had a good job. I had a nice house, nice car. I had a good set of friends and family around me. I was in a relationship which was going great. You know, we were planning our future together and everything. Felt like my life was getting mapped out and it was going in a really good direction. And I always remember a couple of years ago, it was in January, and I was in work and I get a phone call off my brother, and he said to me, when you finish work today, don't go home and don't go to mum and dad's, come straight to mine. And I knew then it was something serious. My dad had been complaining for a few weeks of pains in his shoulder and his back. And he'd been for physio and all this, and he was going for tests. And I knew that this wasn't going to be good news. So I left work and I went to his, and he told me, my dad's got cancer. It's lung cancer and it's terminal. And he's only got a few months to live. And you always hear people say when they find news out like that, that it hits them like a ton of bricks, but it kind of didn't for me. Because, I don't know, I guess I was in a bit of denial. It's like I didn't believe what I was being told, because we left my brothers and we went round to mum and dad's and he just looked normal. You know, and his attitude as well was like, well, it is what it is, so now we can do about it. Let's just crack on. And I think that's what made it all the more unbelievable for me, because it was like, well, dad can't have cancer. Look at him, he's absolutely fine. So I kind of digesting that news, and I guess I was in a little bit of denial. So the next few weeks was a bit weird, really, but felt like I was in a dream. Most of the time I was all right. And I felt all right all of the time, but looking back now, there was definitely days when things started to go wrong inside my head. And I always remember going for a night out with my then girlfriend, and we were going for something to eat and then going to pictures. So just before we left, I nipped to mum and dad's and make sure he was all right. And yeah, he was fine, no problem at all. So we went for a bite to eat, and then we went to the pictures. And I remember being sat in the pictures just before the film come on, and all the lights were still on. And this song come on, and it was an Adele song. And I just completely broke down. It just all come out of me. All this emotion that I didn't even realise I had myself, because I'd felt all right, do you know what I mean? And it just erupted like a volcano. I just sobbed my heart out, and I was literally just sat in the middle of the pictures and just broke down. And she had her arms around me, and I just couldn't control it. It just all come out. So it's kind of like, it just shows that things can affect you without you realising it. You know, I thought I was doing all right, but inside I wasn't. I was kind of in denial, and I was hiding from it. And that kind of carried on then for a few months. And then in the September time, he started to get ill. And then he passed away in the September. And I remember getting a phone call at about 3:45 in the morning. It was my sister-in-law. And she said, your dad's gone. And I broke down for about 5 minutes, because I had my daughter staying with me that night, and she heard me. She come out the room, and I had to tell her. And of course she broke down. So for them 5 minutes, when I got told, I was a son who'd just been told his dad had died. But as soon as my daughter walked out that room, I had to switch, and I had to become a father then, who was telling his children that their granddad had died. So I phoned my two lads and I told them. And of course they were devastated. And then you kind of try and pick up your life then after the funeral and everything. You're trying to come to terms with it, and it's difficult because for me, I couldn't really think about him. I couldn't talk about him. I couldn't think about memories. I wouldn't allow myself, because it was like, I knew if I did, I'd get upset. And I was scared of getting upset for some reason. I don't know why. But I think because I was keeping all of my emotions in, it was having a detrimental effect on my mental health, without a doubt. And I started becoming less and less interested in doing things. I didn't really want to go out. I just didn't want to do anything. You know, I was still getting up, I was still going to work, I was still doing my job. But as soon as work had finished, I just wanted to lock myself away. I didn't want to speak to anyone. And of course that has a major effect on your relationship, you know, because we were in a really good place. Suddenly I just started to change and started to pull back. And like I said, to everybody else, I was probably fine. I was handling it really well. But I wasn't. I was in a bad way. And I guess she was the only person who could see that, because it was our relationship that it affected. You know, I mean, I'd be staying at hers for a few nights, and actually I'd feel great when I was there. But it was when I went home and I was alone with my own thoughts. And that's when I'd go downhill, and then I'd pull back from everybody. I wouldn't speak to my mates, I wouldn't speak to my family, I wouldn't speak to her. I'd just lock myself away and either go sleep all night or watch films or whatever, but I wasn't living my life. And I wasn't looking after myself. You know, I wasn't eating right, I wasn't working out, I wasn't sleeping well. You know, it wasn't that I couldn't sleep, I was choosing not to. I was staying up till 2-3 o'clock in the morning watching crap on TV, and then going to work the next day with feeling like crap and groggy eyes and just terrible. And it was getting worse. I had all these plans, but I didn't have the motivation to carry them out. And that's how it felt. It felt like you're drained of any bit of motivation that you have. And I remember going, we went to Conwy Falls one day. It's a waterfall in Wales because I love waterfalls and stuff. Found them dead peaceful and everything. So she was like, let's go here. It'd be a really good day. It's like, okay. So we went and it was amazing. So scenic and everything. And it was just the two of us there. And it was a cold winter's day, but it was clear blue skies. It was dead fresh. And it was great, but I didn't appreciate it. I didn't appreciate where I was. I didn't appreciate who I was with. I was a shadow of the man that I used to be. And slowly but surely, I started getting worse till in the end, it killed the relationship, and we ended. I remember during that period, I used to spend days on end just lost in my own mind, thinking about everything I used to have, because I'd lost my house as well at this point. I moved back in with my mum, and I was thinking about the house I had, I was thinking about my dad, and I was certainly thinking about the relationship I used to have. I guess I was feeling sorry for myself a little bit, but I was just reminiscing. That's all I was doing, was just reminiscing. You know, I'd go out for a drive in the car and put the music on, and all I'd think about was how my life used to be, what I used to have. I'd sit in my room and do the same for hours on end, just thinking, trapped in my own head. I made a meal and I threw it up on Sunday. I got a lot of things to learn. I said I would and I'd believe in one day before my heart starts to burn. So what's the matter with you? Will you sing me something new? But don't you know the cold and wind and rain? Don't know it only seems to come and go away. Stand by me, nobody knows the way it's gonna be. Stand by me, nobody knows the way it's gonna be. Stand by me, nobody knows the way it's gonna be. Stand by me, nobody knows. Yeah, nobody knows the way it's gonna be. If you're leaving, will you? And I remember it was my 40th birthday party. We had a big party, all my friends and family come, and should have been a really good night, and it was, don't get me wrong, you know, everyone enjoyed it, and I got up and give a speech, and everyone found it dead funny and all that, and it was, should have been a great night, but that person that was on the stage giving that speech, making the room laugh, was acting. I was being the person that I used to be, but I was forcing it, because that night I was an absolute mess.
I love chips. And I was yapped on it straight away. I like that.
I just felt like I had nothing left in my life, and I just felt empty. And I think what made it worse for me was some of that was down to me, And it was easy for me to sit there and say, well, it's not my fault I had depression. You know, I didn't ask for this. And actually, I was right. I didn't ask for it, and it wasn't my fault. But it was my fault that I didn't do anything about it, and that was the problem. And then you kind of get to the point where your thoughts start getting really dark.
I've had a good couple of weeks. I've been feeling really good, and everything's been going really well. And in the last day or two, things have just started creeping up on me again. Where it comes from, like, you know what I mean? It just comes on you like a wave. I could feel this like building up and that. Today it was I could feel it inside, and it's just getting worse all day and it. Shit, man. I'm telling you, right, losing people is the hardest thing in the world. You put on a brave face for everyone. So people think like that, you're doing all right.
He's quite bubbly and outgoing, and he likes to talk in general about anything and everything, really. He likes to make sure that other people are happy and everything as well. And that when his personality is going, that people are sort of bouncing off his personality. He's never really sad. He goes sort of within himself. I usually know through messages, because he'll ask me if I'm busy, and usually if that just instantly indicates that when he starts off with that type of message, or are you in, then I know straight away that there could be something wrong.
But the depression had took such a hold on me that I was really struggling to fight it. And I always remember people have asked, what's it like having depression? And yeah, I could sit here all day and say, you kind of lose the motivation to do anything. You don't want to go out. You don't want to mingle with people. You don't want to see people. You kind of lose all your hopes and dreams, all your aspirations. None of them appeal to me anymore. I couldn't think of anything good that was going to come in the future. And it was interesting, I was watching an interview with Frank Skinner not long ago, and he was talking to this guy who, he was an expert on plant life in the ocean, you know, all the plants that are at the bottom of the ocean. And Frank Skinner asked him a question and said, you know, because they're in the ocean and they're sort of swaying about, how do you know when they're dead? And the guy said, you'd always know when life is there because there's growth. And I thought, that's it. That sums up depression. when you've got depression, you're still alive and you might still be doing things like going to work, but there's no growth anymore. That's gone.
Everything was fine. We had the usual anxieties of being a parent of young kids. We've got three kids. There's 22 months between the boys and there's only 15 months between the middle one and the youngest one. And then we had our little girl. She must have been about 3 weeks old and my husband was complaining of a pea-sized lump in his neck. We got him to check it out and the doctors just kept sending him back saying, it's nothing, your bloods are fine. It might be a swollen saliva gland. It got worse. He went for an ultrasound, was unclear, so they took him for a biopsy. And then that's really when the trouble started because he couldn't move because he had had a little operation on his neck. So I had a 3-year-old, a 15-month-old and a newborn baby. And an extra pair of hands comes in really, really, really handy. And he couldn't hold Libby or pick Regan up. Or Reese for that matter, because they were all toddlers. And then the week later, a really lovely doctor got us in with the ENT specialist who had these results. And we went in, and I remember the first thing, I felt relief and my world crumbled down in a split second because the ENT specialist handled it really badly. And he said to me, so what do you think it is? And I was like, nothing. And my husband went, I think it's lymphoma. And he went, yep, but not just lymphoma, a really rare form of lymphoma. And they were quite excited about this because it was a European strain of something called Burkitt's lymphoma, which is really quite rare. And then that was it. It was a whirlwind. He went to hospital. He had a staging scan. He was really lucky. It was only in his neck. He went into Whiston Hospital. He was in a private room. We said, you'll be in for a week, home for a week, in for a week, home for a week. And then they got him in and was like, no, you won't. You'll be in all the time. And I think in about a 4-month period, he probably came home and saw the kids and was like sat in his own living room about maybe 4 times in the space of about 4 or 5 months because he was too poorly to come home. And obviously for me, that was heartbreaking to see. And people say, I don't know how you did it. But people say, I don't know how you did it with 3 kids that young, like just as a parent, even with Martin there. And I think at the time in them sort of situations, you slap a smile on. And you get on with it because there's bigger and better things you need to be dealing with. And if you fall into this hole of self-pity while it's happening, I don't think we would have got through it. One of us had to be the big man and get on, and Martin physically couldn't do that. And I just became a completely different person. I was really, really anxious all the time. And again, it was a bit like a bad dream and a bit of a blur, but I can remember not wanting to speak, to do anything other than the motions of the day. Because if I thought about anything else, I'd burst into this hysterical, ridiculous tears. My husband was off work one day and he sent grapes to school with the kids and I knew he'd cut them up. But I genuinely at that time thought, my kids are gonna die at school. I felt like there was an accident waiting to happen around every single corner, like something was going to change. I guess our lives like that. I think because it had happened, looking back now, that's what had happened. And I was so scared that something out of my control would make our world fall apart. I knew I was anxious. I'd been to the doctors. They'd put me on something beginning with an S, some type of anti-anxiety medication to basically calm me down. And it wasn't really working. They got me into cognitive behaviour therapy. They told me, you've got generalised anxiety disorder, probably caused by post-traumatic stress. And I was like, yeah. And all these words were going flying at me and they were telling me, you need to take this. You are this person. And I thought, no, it's not me. And then I was in the middle of Liverpool and we took the kids to see a pantomime. And my husband, this is ridiculous, but my husband said, right, go into Shoe and pick a pair of boots for Christmas. And I had a panic attack in the middle of Shoe in Liverpool because I couldn't choose a pair of boots. And it was, and my husband was like, Emma, this is ridiculous. And I physically had a panic attack. I couldn't breathe. I thought I was going to throw up. I had to run out of the shop. But I was like that with everything, absolutely everything, and it was ridiculous. And then that Christmas, I sort of said, I have to change. I can't go through life being scared of what's around the corner or not being able to make a decision and feeling like, literally, being so anxious, I feel like I'm going to die. Like, and that used to be something I used to say all the time. Like, I'd ring my husband at work and I'd be like, I'm so anxious, I'm going to die. This is going to kill me. And he'd be like, no, it's not. But it was a panic. It was like a constant panic attack, probably for a good few years without me realising, until it got to a really bad point. But I was in a constant state of panic, and I started to thrive on that borderline of sanity. Like, if that wasn't there, I couldn't function. And everything was... I remember someone coming out to me, a friend of the family, and saying, you're manic. I was never depressed. I was anxious all the time, which presented as me being up and down. But it was just when I was down, I was quite calm. Because, if I was in the house and I knew everyone was safe. But planning an event to go somewhere or go to a busy shopping centre, it just didn't happen, because it pushed me over the edge. I'd literally get that feeling I was going to die in my chest. I started practicing yoga, and I obviously couldn't go to a class around people, because that would have just, again, said, I'm getting there in the car and being there, I might have died. So I started practicing yoga in my bedroom, watching YouTube videos, all the time. Every time I felt a panic attack coming on and I was in the house, I'd go upstairs. But I felt better. And it was the only thing that I found that didn't have an end point. Like, it wasn't a goal. Like, you go to the gym sometimes and you go, right, I'm going to do this because I want to get a six pack. And that's my goal. But the only goal in yoga was to feel better and stay better. And I think that's why the love of it never ended for me, because everyone still feels shit sometimes. Everyone who has depression and anxiety under wraps, whether it's medicated or not medicated, still falls back into an old pattern sometimes, whether it be for an hour, a day, a week, a few months. And I ended up substituting my medication for yoga, and yoga literally became medicine. And it still is to this day. It makes me think about everything I'm good at and everything positive in my life, rather than waking up in the morning and thinking, well, that's crap, this is going to go wrong today. Which is when you're depressed or you're anxious, is the mindset you have. You think every day something bad's going to happen, or what's the point in doing that, because something bad's going to happen. I started to see the positives in each day, and I knew that came from yoga practice. And I was really not very good. Like, to watch me do yoga, you'd think, You're rubbish. I couldn't touch my toes. I couldn't do the splits. I couldn't do anything that you imagine what yoga is like. But it wasn't so much about what my physical body was doing. It was about what it was doing for my mental state. And then that was it, really. I gradually got better and better. And then I got to a point where I was like, I want to help people. I want people to know that this is available for everybody, and literally everybody, every age, every sex. This can be taught. And my original motive for being a yoga teacher was to go into schools, seeing a lot of children come through us, teenagers, like year 9s, year 11, year 11s, were coming to us already under CAMHS, which is a children's mental health team, smoking weed, taking legal highs to escape their depression and their anxiety. And we're talking like 13, 14 years old. There's so much pressure put on absolutely everybody in our day and age now that no one knows how to handle everyday life anymore. I never felt suicidal, but I did say a lot, you'd all be better off with me if I wasn't here. But I'm well now, and I wasn't well then.
I just thought I'd do a quick one, really. Just been out. Been for tea with my kids, my two sons, my daughter, and my daughter's boyfriend. And I had a really good night, which is good, because a little bit of a rough couple of days. I had a drink at weekend, and I don't normally drink, and when I do, it just knocks me for six. I was going a bit of a downer for a couple of days after I've had a drink, but do you reckon it's a depressive anyway, isn't it? But But yeah, and it just got me thinking, like, because I'd just felt really good. First time in a couple of days, as I say, it's been a bit down, but just went, had a laugh, and kind of forgot about anything else, just about being in the moment, just being there, having a laugh with my kids. And I remember when I went fishing with my lads a few weeks ago as well, we just had a scream. I guess the point I'm trying to make is that sometimes we get so lost in thinking about what we haven't got that you kind of forget what you have got. Do you know what I mean?
Things started to go really downhill. And I was really struggling to come to terms with everything that had gone on in my life the last few years. And I remember waking up one morning, and you know when you wake up sometimes, and for the first sort of few seconds or first minute or so, you kind of forget certain things about your life until you're fully awake. That happened to me. I kind of woke up and I kind of forgot that my dad had passed away, and I'd forgot that my relationship had ended. And it took about 30 seconds for me to suddenly wake up properly, and then I realised, and my stomach turned over, and I just sat there in disbelief, like, has this actually happened to me? Is this where I am now? And I remember getting up and thinking, something's got to give here. I can't carry on like this. And I phoned in work, my head was absolutely all over the place. And I phoned in work and said, I can't come in today. And I spent the whole day just sat thinking and planning. And I come to a decision that day that I'm finally going to do something about it. I'm not going to carry on living my life like this. So the decision was made. I knew what I wanted to do. I wanted to beat it, and I wanted to get better, and I wanted to become an even better person than I was before. The problem I had was I didn't know how to. So I started doing a bit of research, and I compiled a list of all the different things that you can try and do to overcome mental health issues. And that list was from counselling to hypnotherapy, CBT, health and fitness, all sorts. And I put this list together and decided, right, I'm going to give them all a go. I'm going to give them all a try and see if any of it works for me. And so that's what I did. And I just started documenting it on my phone, and talking about the experiences that I was having. And I kind of wanted to do it because I wanted to see if there was a difference in the person I was to the person I was becoming. So I set off on this journey, and that journey became this documentary. And I wanted to share it because I just feel like if it can help one person, if one person watches this and it helps them, then it's job done. So off I went, phone in hand, to start my journey. Right, I'm just on my way to go and get hypnotised. I've never been hypnotised before. I'm one of them people who believes I can't be hypnotised. But from what people have said to me is that you don't feel like you've gone under, but you actually have. So I'm just going to give it a go. Don't really know what to expect. I don't know what I'm going to gain from it. But I contacted this lady who does it, explained that I've been feeling up and down. I can't get
I can't get past certain aspects of things in my head, like my dad passing away and splitting up with my girlfriend and all that sort of stuff. So she said it's the sort of thing that she deals with all the time, and it's about increasing my mood, which I kind of, yeah, I kind of get that. Increase your own mood and then you're able to deal with other stuff. So whether it'll work or not, I don't know. It's just another thing to try. Not everyone's cup of tea, might not be mine, but I'll give it a go. And for all I know, I could come out thinking my name's Dave and walking like a chicken for the next couple of weeks. I don't know, because I've not told anyone I'm coming. I've come on my own. This could be the last time you speak to Andy. Andy might disappear forever. Would that be a good thing? Don't know. So, got 15 minutes to pass before I go in and allow my mind to be taken. It's been, I don't know if it's good to come today actually, because I'm actually feeling all right. I felt all right for a couple of days. Earlier in the week, I had a couple of down days, which were really, really bad. I just couldn't pick myself up. I just had obsessive thoughts about my dad, my ex-girlfriend, my nephew. And I just couldn't pick myself up out of it. And I guess it had been great to come here and do this then, when I was feeling like that, because then you've really, you know, I'd come out of here and I'd almost know instantly if it's worked, whereas today, the last day or two, I'm on top of things, I'm feeling good. So I don't know if it's going to work, really. But all you can do is try and see how I am afterwards. Probably better that I'm videoing it, actually, because I might be able to look back at these videos and remember who I actually was, if she changes my name and personality. So, can't put it off any longer. Let's do it, and I'll see you on the other side.
I felt like hypnotherapy was a good thing. But when I went, I felt like I got more out of being sat there talking to her, because she was, you know, she was an expert and on psychology and all this sort of stuff. So I got more out of that chat I had with her than the actual hypnotherapy itself. It kind of feels like when I was at the height of my depression, it felt like I had a bit of a war going on in my head. One side saying, come on, let's beat this, let's get out there, let's do this, let's do that. The other part saying, no, you can't. You can't do it like that. Just stay in. There's no point. Everything's pointless. And you're getting all these mixed signals in your mind, and your brain's getting all mixed up, and you don't really know what you want to do. And I felt like speaking to her actually helped, because it was almost like I was able to unload my thoughts, and she was able to give me some feedback on it. And I felt like that really was the start of me getting a bit of help. I was thinking, there's something in this. I feel like that worked for me a little bit. In the midst of all this, I'd put something out on social media, because I started to think, how many other people out there are actually suffering the same as what I have? So I put a little thing out on social media, and I kind of got blew away by the response. With loads of people come forward, messaging me, people I've known for years who come forward to say they've been suffering. I was like, wow, really? No, I had no idea. Loads of people that I didn't even know. So I set up the idea that actually let's include other people. And I tell you what was funny about that, it more than anything, it highlighted how sometimes people are asking for help and you don't realise it. Because around that period that I put it out on social media, I started seeing loads of posts off people about mental health and stuff like that. And I stupidly at the time thinking, wow, is my little post had such an effect? So one day I thought, actually, let's have a look into that. So I went through my timeline and I went back over 12 months. And it quickly became apparent that all these messages that and pictures that people were putting up about mental health and feeling good, they were always there. People had always been posting stuff like that. I just hadn't seen it. So decided to get a few other people on board who come forward and said they would like to take part. So I thought it's one way of showing how there's more than you that's feeling like this. Because there'll be people out there now who are suffering with a mental health issue, and maybe they think they're the only person in the world and they're alone in this, but they're not. So getting other people on board was really important to show that you're not alone.
Got home from work one night and walked up to his flat, and you know, I used to sleep on the couch, and he passed me on his way to the toilet and like rubbed my head and said good night, son, and he went into his bedroom, and then that's when I heard him obviously at the deck. I ran in, and you know, he's losing his colour, he's not breathing, he's, you know, starting to clot on the side of his head, and having to bring an ambulance and, you know, administer like first aid on my own dad while he's lying there lifeless. And the toughest thing for me was that I knew that he was gone at that moment, pushing on his chest, and you know, and I just knew it. I was looking at him thinking that this is just not helping, but I had to do it. And then obviously when the ambulance arrived, it was then what got to me in the months after it was that I felt like I was lying to everyone on that day, because I was ringing my sisters and brothers and saying, look, dad's been rushed into hospital. You know, he's going to be all right. It's going to be all right. And that's what I kept saying to everyone, because it was kind of calming me down a bit. I couldn't let any emotion out when it was all happening. I was watching them operate on him and obviously trying to revive him. And then I remember they all stepped away when they basically said, look, this, you know, he's gone. And it was like being on the outside. It was like I could see myself. I buried my head in my knees and I was screaming. And next thing I looked up and my mum was fighting with my younger brother, Liam, to stop him from going in and seeing my dad. And that's when it just all clicked. I'd snapped out of whatever it was, shot up and went for him and grabbed him and just said, look, it's going to be okay. Because I didn't want him to go through anything that I had to go through. And I think that moment kind of buried all the grief inside me. I'd have my own moments on my own, but I didn't grieve in the first sort of year or so. I drank quite a lot. I was only young anyway, so it was kind of, you know, it was masked by the fact that, you know, I'm just a youngster going out and having a drink. He's all right. But, you know, I was going out on weekdays and drinking a lot and spending a lot of money that I couldn't really afford to spend. But knowing that in that moment, I forgot about everything. But then the morning after, it had hit you and you'd think, you know, I've made myself worse. I feel worse now than I did before I started, so let's get back on the drink. And I had friends and family obviously beside me that were helping me during that time, but I'd never opened up to any of them. Never really shared with them what I was feeling deep down. I went and met with Rochdale Hornets club just outside Manchester, and I was at university at the time, and they agreed to take me on a voluntary basis to do what I've always wanted to do. And I felt incredible. I felt like I cracked it, like I've made my break. And first person I rang was my mum and told her over the phone. I was like, Mum, I'm going to be Rochdale and Oneills Media Manager. And I was about to ring my dad and I thought, you know what, I want to see him. I want to tell him in the flesh. I want to see how much it means to him, because he always was always, you know, behind me and everything I wanted to do, and making him proud was like one of the most important things to me. The next time I got to see him was obviously when he passed away. So that hurt a lot. And then going and doing the job that I was doing, it's kind of bittersweet. I was loving doing it, but in the back of my mind, every now and again, I'd think, you know, if my dad could see me now, I'd be proud. And he didn't even know. My current girlfriend, Becky, she's the person that I opened up to first about all these issues, and I just like tore myself down to her. I just kind of broke down one day. I couldn't even tell you what day it was, what was happening, why it was, but I just got to that point where I needed to speak to someone. And up until then, I hadn't took any steps to become better mentally, because it made me feel weak. I didn't want to go and see a doctor or a therapist or anything like that. I didn't want to admit that I had a problem, because I was always fine. I'm always the kind of person that's smiling and laughing and joking. No one would know that I had any issues or problems going on. So to let that off my shoulders was a massive thing, and it felt good. It felt better than when I was hitting the drink hard. Felt better than anything else I'd ever done. So, but admitting that to my family and my mum was something that I wasn't able to do straight away. I didn't want her to worry about me. I didn't want to put any extra stress on her shoulders. But there was days where I didn't want to get out of bed. You know, I'd said in my head, right, I'm going to do this, this and this today. And when it comes to waking up, I'd just roll back over and bury myself under the cover, and it'd just be kind of like, I just want to hide away today. I don't want to face anyone or anything. I had a lot of days like that, and I think maybe that's what got me to the point where I just needed to get it all out, because when I was alone, no one was seeing the effects it had all had on me. You've got to admit that something's wrong. You can't just go around trying to be the big man all the time. Just because you're a bloke, you know, things get to you, things upset you, things affect you. And I'd gone to a couple of offload sessions at Widnes Vikings just to see if they'd help. They were the only kind of help that I got from others. Felt good to sit in a room with people that were going through similar kind of situations, and blokes that just weren't afraid to just sit there and talk about what was going on. Ask questions, ask for advice. And I come home from that and I just bawled my eyes out to my mum, and I just said, I give up. I can't do this anymore. I'm not going to ever succeed or get to where I want to be. And that's the first time she'd ever seen anything like that from me. And that's when I eventually sat down and just said, look, I'm trying to look for help. I'm trying to get better because I'm struggling mentally. It was tough. I was a lot of looking at the ground and not being able to look her in the eye, and it was probably one of the hardest things I've done. That was tough to open up to her, but you know, now we talk about it, she'd genuinely ask how I am in that sense, and you know, I know that I can come to her now. It's tough when you think that you've got no one to go to about things like this. More recently than ever, I'm trying to physically become better, mentally become better by talking about my issues and opening up rather than keeping it all in. If I hadn't have spoke up that one day just out of the blue, if I hadn't have had that breakdown in front of my mum, then I dread to think of how far it could have gone. I know that I'm not going to ever be fully over what's happened to me. And you know, there's still days where I think, you know, why did it happen and why him and what did he ever do wrong? What did I ever do wrong to deserve that? But if you live your life like that, you're not going to get anywhere. And it especially wouldn't make him proud, which is the one thing that I want to do. There's nothing more powerful in my experience than just talking, than just those thoughts that you're having alone and those conversations you're having in your own head. Find someone that you trust, find someone that you love, find someone that means a lot to you, and have those conversations with them. Talk, ask for help, because it isn't weak to speak up to someone and tell them what you're going through. You know, it takes a lot to go up to someone and lay it all out there and tell them the things that you're most scared of opening up about. But the feeling of relief when you do something like that, that's the kind of feeling that can turn your life around and put you in a different perspective. You can sit and have these conversations in your head for the rest of your life, and it'll just lead to you, you know, you're getting worse and worse and worse, but the moment that you speak to someone, then you're already taking steps to make yourself better.
Right, so it's Saturday night, and I had a choice of staying in and doing nothing and letting my head go up my arse, or coming out, which I didn't want to do. You've got to force yourself, and we've come for a walk up wet and windy Pexhill. Because sometimes it's good just to get out the house and do something different, focus your mind. But I had to force myself. Sometimes that's what you've got to do. And it's even better when you come with people that are close to you, like your daughter, who's come in £400 shoes. And she's clearly made up about it. But you know what? It might be pouring down, and it might be quite cold, but it's better than staying in the house.
So after the hypnotherapy, I started to think about what am I going to try next on my list. And looking at my experience through that hypnotherapy and the fact that I actually got more out of just chatting to the woman, I thought counselling was the natural thing to do next. So I had a look online. I didn't want to go through the GP just because there can be a bit of a wait, and I just wanted to do it now. So I found a counsellor online, local, who I had to pay for myself, but at least I could get an appointment straight away. And off I went, and I took it from there.
So I had my first counselling session today. It was quite emotional. Felt weird speaking to someone that I'd never met before and telling them how I thought about stuff, and guess for the first time I'd proper spoke to somebody about everything, especially my dad. Because I've really had trouble like thinking about him and stuff, even though it's been quite a while now, but today I did. And even though I got emotional, it felt really good. And managed to speak about, well, quite a lot of stuff, mainly my dad. And my relationship breaking down, and really just talking about me and my feelings and actions, really, do you know what I mean? And I've got to say, I've actually come out of there and felt, I don't know, I felt lighter somehow. Like it had lifted a bit of a weight off my shoulder. And I seem to connect with her, like, really quickly. She's, like, really good at describing things, and she challenged me a little bit, actually, when I was in there. But I kind of like that, do you know what I mean? I didn't want to just go there and just be sat chatting and not really getting anywhere. I may as well just talk to the fucking phone if I'm going to do that, do you know what I mean? But she didn't. She like, challenged me a little bit and that, so... Yeah, I kind of feel quite positive, even though it's only been one session. So I'll roll on next week when I have my next session, so... Yeah, fingers crossed. Okay, so it's Saturday afternoon. I've got the house to myself. My mum's away for the weekend. I'm feeling pretty good today. It's the first day this week, really, because it's not been a good week at all. I feel more positive today. I've had some good sessions. Well, I had a good session with a counsellor yesterday and come up with some realisations, really. And I guess the theme is all about denial. How many of us are actually in denial over things that are really bothering us, and we're hoping that things will work themselves out, and they don't. And you're in denial over it because you think they will work themselves out. And I think one way of dealing with it is accepting the situation as is and accepting that things ain't going to work themselves out in this particular situation. And I think if you do that, you can then begin to understand it, handle it, and move on from it and not have it weigh you down, because it's weighed me down. It's weighed me stuck down somewhat chronic for the last few months. And it's difficult. It's not an easy thing to do. But you have to accept that that's what's happened, and there's no going back from it. So, you know, it's like if you don't put the effort in to something and it goes tits up, there's no point crying about it. You have to accept it. It's like having the numbers for the lottery and just not being asked to go and put them on one day, and then suddenly your numbers come up. What are you going to do? It's your own fault. You wasn't asked to put the numbers on. You can't go to Camelot or whoever it is that does it now and say, look, I was going to put the numbers on. This is real. This is my numbers. Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah, we'll give you all the money then. Nah. I'm sorry, you couldn't be asked to go and put the numbers on, so you ain't won the lottery. What do you do about that? You have to accept it. You have to accept I could not be asked to do it, and that's why I've not got what I wanted. And once you accept that, you can say, right, I'll move on from that now, and I'll either keep putting the numbers on, or I'll work harder and earn more money, whatever it may be. And it's the same, similar situation, you know. It's like you need to figure a different plan out now. But I wouldn't be looking at a different plan if I stayed in denial. Get your head out of the clouds. Be realistic. Accept your situation. Accept it. And then deal with it. Because a brighter future can be right around the corner once you do that. But you'll never go around that corner while you're in denial. You'll stay where you are. That's it.
I've got to say, I think the counselling kick-started everything for me. I don't think counselling's for everybody, and I don't think every counsellor is for you. I think you've got to fit with that counsellor, and I definitely fit with her. She challenged me. She challenged my thoughts when I was in there. It wasn't a case of her pandering to me and making me feel a bit better. She challenged how I thought about things, and that's what I needed. I needed somebody to challenge me. But she also would, I'm quite a visual person. She would, when she would explain stuff, she would do it very visually and paint pictures in my mind. And I think counselling at that moment was the biggest thing that helped me by far. I was able to unload everything and then start piecing it all back together so it could make some sense in my head. Because I'd lost myself. I'd completely lost myself. I didn't know who I was anymore. I didn't know where I was going. And I didn't know what I wanted in life. And what counselling did for me was it helped me to figure all that out. Get me back to being me. But on a different path. And know what I want in life and get focused. And it started to give me the motivation that actually things can get better, things can change. And that was the next step.
So counselling's been going really well. Just feeling really, really good every time I've been there now. Made a lot of progress discussing mainly me, really, do you know what I mean? About how I am and how I feel and what decisions I've been making in my life and why and stuff like that. And it's been eye-opening, do you know what I mean? It really has. I feel like I've come a long way. But I kind of felt like I needed to step it up a little bit. So decided to set myself a goal. Created this project called Earn for Earn. And the idea is to raise as much money as we can for cancer charities and do it all in honour of my dad. So the first thing we signed up for was the McMillan Mighty Hike, which is a 26-mile hike across the Peak District. So phoned up, spoke to this geezer on the phone, said to him, I've never done it like this before, blah, blah, blah. Dead supportive, dead grateful, like, yeah, you know, it'd be great, we'll send you all the stuff. So I signed up for that with my daughter and my daughter's boyfriend. And we've booked in a hotel to go and stay overnight and then do the hike tomorrow. Bit nervous. Don't know how it's going to go. Don't even know if we'll make it. But looking forward to it, and it'll be, I'm hoping, what I want more than anything is, apart from to raise money for McMillan and do it in my dad's honour, which will be amazing, but to get a sense of achievement. You know, when I look back to where I was, say, 2 months ago, I was broken, and I feel like I'm getting fixed, slowly but surely. And this is another step to putting myself together, but in a better way than I was beforehand. So I can't wait. I can't wait for tomorrow. Got me pack, McMillan pack, my t-shirt and everything all ready. Walking boots and that. And then take it from there. So let's see how tomorrow goes. So we're 7 miles into this Peak District trek, 19 miles to go, and literally in the middle of the Peak District, just surrounded by hills and sheep and grass, and it's stunning. It makes you realise there's places like this all around us, liking it. Look at this. Just got to enjoy it, embrace it. Beautiful. So, 7 miles in, you're not looking your best, Josh. How are you feeling? Miles in, how are you feeling?
Good.
Wasn't what you said off camera. It's just a question. How do you think it's going? Okay, that's great. I think it's going shit. Can't stand it and I can't wait to get up.
You wanna know where to go?
If you're depressed, it's somewhere like this, man. It's just so peaceful. All you can hear is the running water. Sounds, running water, and that's it. It's hard to come places like this when you're depressed, but you've got to force yourself because it's worth it in the end.
Fucking daft that on and everything. Right, that's the Peak District done. That was hard, man. That was well harder than I thought it was going to be. We nearly quit a good few times, I'll be honest with you. Just even like having a little sit down on a rock for like 10 seconds was like heaven. My legs are in bits, my ankles are in bits. But crossing that finishing line was just, it was immense, man. Proper immense. And I think we've raised about 800 quid as well. So, brilliant. I can't believe we've done it, if I'm honest with you. I actually can't believe it. We had every kind of weather. There was bright sunshine, then there was wind, then it absolutely poured down, then it went dead cold. Crazy, man. But, done it in the end, and that's all that matters. And I honestly can't believe I've done something like that. I know to some people that's probably, you know, it's no big deal, but to me, that's massive, man. That's proper massive. Just buzzing. I'm proper buzzing. It was really good because I had a counselling session the day before we left. And that went really well. I've been really progressing. Actually spoke to her about possibility of even going Conway Falls, but we had a discussion about it and I did get a bit upset, like, so she was like, you're not ready to do that, so that's off the table at the moment, but you know what, it doesn't matter. I've got to look at the positives, and the positives are I've just done 26 mile over the Peak District. Me, fuck's all that about, man? And yeah, just buzzing. And nice one for everyone who supported as well and donated, because that's what it's all about at the end of the day. Yeah, superb.
My problem started one day when my uncle died. He was like my mum's brother. They were sort of really close. Oh, James, I live just over Alton View. I'll never forget, I was in work one day and I got a phone call to say he'd collapsed. His wife had rung me to say he'd collapsed, and could I go over? Because it was only just over Alton View Bridge, like the bottom of Ireland Street where he lived. I got there, but she'd phoned me before she'd phoned an ambulance, which you look back now and you sort of think, well, that's nice, because they respect you for, obviously she's thought a lot of me to ring me first. But then you sort of got there and he'd had a heart attack, a massive heart attack. So me and his neighbour were doing like trying to revive him, resuscitate him and that, but unfortunately we didn't, and he passed on. And I think a lot of my initial problems stemmed from that, because I never spoke to anyone. It sort of played on your mind, and you'd have a picture in your mind of how he was lying on the floor and stuff. I mean, thankfully, I went to see him when, obviously before his funeral, like they prepared him and put him in the coffin. So I had a nice vision of him, but now and again, you just get that little thing back that you see him there. And I never spoke to anyone. I never told anyone about this for years. Probably about 10, 15 years it was like, but it's always there in the back of your mind and it plays on you and you think, well, could he have done this different? Would this have happened? Could that have happened, you know? And it couldn't, everything. I'm a firm believer in everything happens in life for a reason. I think I was glad I was there that day that he died because he was a special person to me. And my mum took bad over time. She had illnesses and my dad wasn't well. Just constant pressures to work and have your family and still be doing what you do in your day-to-day job as well. It's not the easiest job in the world dealing with the public day in, day out, because you might have a right mood on you, but you can't take that on other people just because they're members of the public in your place of work. I had a bit of a life-changing thing a few years back in 2014, where I was working at the time, I was working at the bowling club, Winners Bowling Club down there, and I just got, it's part of doing the job that I do, where you're running pubs and clubs, it's always in the back of your mind that something could happen. I was unfortunate enough to be attacked in an armed robbery that sent me off the edge, I think. You don't realise at the time. I got a bit of a kick in, lost a couple of teeth and things like that, but it's only a couple of teeth. I've had worse playing rugby. It's when you're a kid, you sort of laugh off bumps and scrapes. But I think it was the mental scars that were left that caused me an awful lot of my problems. I think they made like threats. They were threatened, they were going to shoot me when I was in the club. But then they made threats to say to my family, to my kids, that they had someone who was going to do something bad to my kids if we didn't cooperate. So you sort of stop and think. But then from that moment on, it's just like, it's always in the back of your mind. You'd have like, it sounds stupid, but like you see on the telly, you'd have flashbacks, and I had an image in my mind of like what had happened to my kids, what they said they were going to do to them, and that. And that's the bit of a kicking's nothing. I'm a big lad, I can take a bit of a kicking. Not that I'm offering for people to come and give me a kicking, but you know, I'm robust, and you sort of shrug things like that off because it's part of the job. I've had it in the past. But I've been hit with pill cues and stuff like that. But it's the mental scars. The mental side of things was what drove me over the edge. Every time I'd shut my eyes, I could see these people, like, they threatened to shoot my kids. I could see it. And even though they hadn't, and they just say that to frighten you, that was my trigger. I think that caused me an awful lot of my problems from, like, 2014 to now. Even now, it happens now and again, where I'll wake up in the night just crying because I've had a bit of a dream and stuff. But I just think from that moment on, semi-life changed. I was drinking every night because I couldn't sleep and because I didn't want to have bad dreams. I'd finish work and go home and sit and have drink a bottle of cider or a quart bottle of vodka, sat in my car outside the house, go in, fall asleep on the couch and just try and blank things out, just using it as a crutch rather than seeking proper help. I was thinking, well, I'll just deal with this, I'll do that. But then I'd get up the next day, because I'm not a drinker anyway. I've never been a big drinker. I'd get up the next day, fit for nothing. So I was taking all sorts of tablets and pills and things to give me that kick to get through the day and work. And then I finished work and go home and have a drink again. It was just, I was on a massive downward spiral. Led to me, like, twice, I tried to take my own life. Fortunately, I was stopped by people both times because suicide's not a great thing, obviously. It's a way out, it solved my problems, but it's the problems that it leaves behind. I've seen it with friends that have done it and it's caused problems. I've lost a few good mates through that, and it's like, I couldn't do that. No matter how worthless you feel, or how down you feel, I couldn't do that to my kids, I don't think. I think that's the big thing that stops me doing it, is the mess it'd leave behind for them. I was fortunate that on one of these occasions, when I got stopped, I'd had a counselling session that day, and it was my counsellor that noticed that something was like different. I mean, you go and you just open up to someone at counselling. Something was a bit different that day, a bit worse than more severe than what it'd been other times. So while I was in there, she phoned my doctor, and my doctor come down to see me. But I'd planned, I'd left notes and everything, I'd planned. I'd spent about 3 weeks planning, just tidying up bits and pieces to just make it sound like a clean getaway, if that makes sense. But it wasn't for Joanne, my counsellor. I wouldn't be here today. I can say that, hand on heart sort of thing. From that moment on, I realised it was helpful. I was getting more counselling. I've had a bit of psychotherapy, which has helped. I've been hypnotised once, just like regress sort of thing, just to see if that helped, just clear problems, which for me it did. I felt like I was existing while I was taking tablets rather than living, and I didn't want that anymore. I wanted to be the person that I am inside, not the shell that I'd become. So I've gradually weaned myself off like antidepressants and sleeping tablets, and that's been good. It's like a champagne bottle sort of thing for me, and every time something bad happens, you give the bottle a little shake, and if you shake that bottle enough over, it might be a week, it might be a month, a couple of months, that cork's just going to explode out of that bottle, and that's when everything goes bad. I'm not afraid anymore that people know how I'm feeling. I think that was a big thing. You just bottle your fears up. And like you say, you bottle your feelings up, you don't tell nobody nothing. But I couldn't have done this today, like sitting chatting to you and opening up about what I've been through and how I feel. I wouldn't have done that 5 years ago.
So I've been doing some thinking and some research into positive thinking, positive mindset. And there's this geezer, this psychologist in America, who, it wasn't his research, but it was research done for some book, which basically says that when you start thinking a certain type of a thought, your brain thinks that that's what your mind needs, so it'll flood your mind with them type of thoughts. So if you have a negative thought about something, your brain thinks that's what you need to be thinking about, and it'll keep flooding it with them thoughts, and that's where you get the obsessive thinking coming in, where you can't stop thinking about something. So he's saying what you need to do is make the thoughts positive, force the thoughts to be positive, and then your brain will flood it and keep flooding it with positive thoughts. So I'm thinking about the type of weekend he had, where he had really negative thoughts and I couldn't stop it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a little experiment. So I'm going to write down a load of positive things that I think are positive about me and my life, and things that kind of make me happy, and I'm going to try and force myself to think about them thoughts and see whether or not it works, and see whether or not by doing that it my brain automatically keeps flooding it with positivity. I don't know whether it'll work, because I know when at the weekend I really struggled with controlling my thoughts and stopping the negativity, but maybe if I write it down first, so I know what I need to be thinking about, then it'll work. So tonight I'm going to write down all the positive things, and then tomorrow when I wake up, I'm going to read it, and I'm going to continue to force myself to think about them things all day, and see whether or not I can get to the point where my brain automatically thinks about them positive things without me trying, and seeing if it picks my mood up.
got to be worth a try.
My name is Christine, and I'm a counsellor, and I qualified in 2003. Been in the job a long time, but I retired 3 years ago. So I became ill shortly after that, a physical illness with a thyroid disease, what I didn't know at the time, and I was only diagnosed last year. But during that time, I started to suffer from anxiety. I'd lost weight, I had a lot of problems, I couldn't sleep, I was suffering anxiety, palpitations, I had a really high heart rate, high blood pressure, a lot of different things. And then I finally got a diagnosis of I was thyroid toxic, I had hyperthyroidism, and a further diagnosis of Graves' disease. So that explained why I was having anxiety, because hyperthyroidism causes anxiety. So I thought, okay. So I felt a bit calmer then, because my anxiety was increased because I was thinking other things. So the medication, once we got the toxicity, the thyroid toxicity under control, the anxiety dropped out. But then, of course, I had to go on treatment to stop my thyroid working. So it didn't happen again, where you'd have become critically ill with the thyroid disease. And at that point, I became more quite low then, because it sort of slowed you up. The side effects of that medication was quite intolerable, I found, because I'd always been a really active person. A lot of the times I felt absolutely useless. I've got a family at home. I mean, they're growing up, a husband and two daughters. But at the same time, I was always the mother hen, you know, looking out for them, and that, especially since I retired. And I'd get out of bed, and I literally couldn't do anything. I couldn't think about what we were going to have for dinner that evening, what needed washing and stuff like that. If they'd left messages or just little tasks, or if I'd made promises to do things, and would feel absolutely useless. And then that, of course, when you start having these thoughts that I'm useless, all them negative chemicals that start rushing through your body, so you start feeling lower. And then your sense of self-worth sort of like diminishes. They can't see me leg in plaster, or I didn't have a bandage around my head. It was like, well, you don't look sick, you look great today. And it's like, you just don't know how hollow and what I haven't got inside me today, and how hard it's been for me to sort of make this journey from A to B, you know. So I went to my GP, but I was still having a really erratic heart rate. Sometimes it was really low, other times it was sky high. And I said, I'm going to go to the gym, I want to do something. She was saying, well, maybe we, you know, could wait a little bit. And I was like, no, I want to go now. So I got in touch with a personal trainer here. I wanted to do something on my own, because I had thyroid toxic myopathy, which is where all your muscles waste in your legs and your arms. So I really didn't have any strength or energy. And I thought, I was telling myself I wouldn't be able to do it. So I thought, right, if I just have a personal trainer, it might be something I can see if it can help me. And it did. So within a couple of weeks, I was in absolute agony going through, but the personal trainer understood my illness, knew what I was doing, worked with me. I started feeling strong again, serotonin and all the things that like boost up, because I did start feeling good about myself. I realised it wasn't something that was going to keep me incapacitated. There was a way forward. There was days I still woke up where I thought, oh, I can't do this, but it was, I put one foot in front of the other. I've just got to sit in my car today. So I'd get to my car, I've got to turn my car on, I've got to drive to the gym. And I'd do it, even if it didn't feel like doing it. And then I'd come out of the session feeling really, really good about myself, because my endorphins were racing around my body. I thought, right, that's another step forward. Everybody is susceptible to periods of emotional instability, you know, knocks to the emotional health, mental health, if you want to call it. You know, everybody is, as much as everybody is, you know, in a position to have really positive mental health and good times, they are. Why can't that person have, you know, times of periods of lowness in their life and emotional instability as well? Everybody, absolutely everybody. I think the difference is, but you're absolutely right, people do say, you know, because of your profession, well, you know, you'll pull yourself out of it. Yeah, you can pull yourself out of it, but it's not always on your own. You need a toolbox. And, you know, I would dive into my toolbox the same way I would dive into that toolbox to help a client, to help myself. But it's still a struggle. It's the same struggle. And I think probably kinder to myself for that, because I've been, and I get quite emotional sitting with other people who've been, you know, in going through some of the worst times of their life. You know, and I know that they're my strength, and they were my strength when I was at my lowest. So, you know, I've sat with people who've really been through some traumatic times. If they can do it, I can do it, you know, to get myself through this. I feel transformed, I really do. The very fact that I can get out in and out of my car without being in pain and wincing, can get up the stairs without effort, I can bend down again, pick my dog up, and, you know, it's been transformational. Even turning over in bed, I just couldn't do it because I was in so much pain. Science tells us that the mind and the body are not separate, they do work together. So if you can improve your physical health, in turn you can improve your psychological health, your mental health as well. They go hand in hand.
So things were going really well. I've been going through the counselling, and the counselling had finished, and I felt in a really good place. I knew I still had a long way to go, but I was on a good path. And I started to have doubts about making the documentary. I started to think people are going to think I'm just stupid. People are going to take no notice of it. So I kind of went through a little period of thinking, you know, just keep doing your thing, keep on your journey, but you don't need to document it. And then I got a phone call in work one day off my brother. And my nephew had took his own life. And that was a difficult time for the whole family, really, you know. And it's hard to put into words when something like that happens, but it's something you're never going to get over. But what it did do was made me realise that I have to finish this. I have to do it, because if making this documentary helps one person, just one person, then it's worth it. You know, and there'll be lots of people sat there now who might be watching this, who are going through a difficult time. And if it helps one of them, then it's job done.
So I've not had the best couple of days, to be fair. Started at the weekend, got up and I don't know, just felt down. But the problem I had was my thoughts. Started get that way where a negative thought will come into my head, and it could be about my dad, it could be about his illness or him passing away, and it just doesn't stop. But it kind of builds up in your mind till it's like non-stop, and it's over and over again, and it gets faster and faster till you're at the point where that's all you're thinking about, non-stop, completely and utterly obsessive thoughts, like you can't stop. And I was like that for 2 days. And it just brings you down. And it's like your thoughts are ruminating and your mind's ruminating non-stop. Just learned that word. That's why I used it. Make yourself look good. I just couldn't control it. I didn't want to be thinking them thoughts. I wanted it to stop. I wanted to think of happy thoughts, but you just couldn't do it. I couldn't bring myself to do it. Couldn't pick myself up no matter what I tried. And today I feel a little bit better. I feel like I've got more control over my thoughts again now. Until next time, I suppose. But it doesn't half bring you down. And then I also realised that I've been kind of stuck in a routine, this rut of getting up, going work, coming home, making a brew, sitting and watching films all night. Until the next day. And I get up, go work, come home, make a brew, watch films all night. Don't see anyone, don't interact with anyone. Don't do nothing. So I thought, I need to try and change it. I don't see my mates, I don't go out, I don't do anything. I want to, but I don't want to at the same time. I just want to stay in. Don't feel like I've got the energy to speak to people or see anyone. It kind of creeps up on you. So I thought, need to break the routine. So I thought tonight I've had to force myself rather than just sitting in, come out and bring a dog for a walk, just to do something, just to break that routine, break that cycle that I'm stuck in. It feels good, it's quite fresh out here and it kind of clears the mind a little bit. I've got to do more of it, stop letting it defeat me. So I've been thinking longer term, what's the first step in trying to become that better person that I want to be, trying to reach my goals. And they say healthy body, healthy mind, don't they? Now I've been in the gym off and on over the years. I've never really stuck at it. Tried eating healthy, but I get a bit lazy and end up eating crap anyway. So I've enlisted the help of a personal trainer, spoke to him, had a good chat, and I've paid for a block booking, 10 sessions, and he's going to do me a meal plan, and I'm going to try and stick to it. And my goal is I want to try and get a six pack, because I just feel like a six pack, it's not about vanity. I suppose it is a little bit, but you know, it takes so much to try and get a six pack, because it's, you've got to eat right, you've got to work out, you've got to be completely and utterly focused and disciplined. And to me, that's a sign of someone who's able to do that, and that's what I want to do. So tomorrow I have my first session and we'll see how much it affects my mind and if it brings me up at all. Because I'm out of breath just wanting a dog. Let's see how we do. Right. Just finished. Let's finish a personal trainer. Jesus Christ. That was hard work. Okay, another heart attack. That was hard work, that. But I feel fucking great. Shouldn't swear, should I? But I do. I don't think I'm going to be able to walk tomorrow, like, but that was much better than going to the gym on your own. because you tend to go and don't really push myself, don't really have a proper workout. You just out of like a talking gesture, do you know what I mean? Whereas that tonight, I've worked out. And I'm only sorry that I didn't do that sooner. So, you know, he obviously stays with you while you're doing your exercises and stuff. I think what I found really beneficial, other than him pushing you to do more, was him explaining how to do the exercises properly. I've been doing exercises for years, but he's really shown me the form that I should do, and I couldn't feel it, like, when I was doing the bicep curls and stuff like that, I could really feel it in my arms, when, in the past, when I've been doing bicep curls on my own, I've not felt it. It's not felt like I've had a workout, but that felt like I had a workout, and I'm absolutely wrecked. I can barely breathe, but I feel on top of the world. Like proper, like buzzing, do you know what I mean? Long may it continue. Maybe it's proof in the saying about how exercise is good for your mind. Certainly feels it at the minute. Highly recommended, I'm telling you. So I've got my diet plan. So I'm gonna go home now. I'm gonna have protein shake. I'm gonna grab a shower. And I'm gonna make me tea. And I'm gonna have some chicken sausages with whole grain rice and broccoli. Sounds good, man. This is better than going home after work, having a brew, having a few bars of chocolate, and going to sleep. And I'm waking up at 8 o'clock, groggy as out, and having some chips or something. This is well better. Well better. Let's bring it on. and it's been long and it's been hard, but I've got to say, I feel fucking ace.
What can I say about health and fitness? Apart from, it changed my life. Completely. And I never thought it would. I had my doubts. But it has. You know, I started going to the gym on my own, but I kind of wasn't working out properly. I was kind of going, but it was a token gesture, you know what I mean? I'd come out and I'd be like, yeah, I've been to the gym, how good am I? But I hadn't really worked out. And that's why I enlisted this personal trainer. And he changed my life. You know, not just through the workouts, because yeah, he'd proper push me and like towards the end of each workout, I'd be half dead. But he would show me how to work out properly, for a start, because I'd been doing it wrong for years. And he obviously gave me a full meal plan as well, so I started to eat right. And you kind of want to eat right because you've been in the gym. You're like, I'm not going to go home now and eat a load of crap, because it's, otherwise I've just wasted all this energy doing this. So you're kind of more determined to eat right and make sure you stay on that course. But it wasn't just the workouts and the diet plan and that. It was his support. You know, we met for a coffee before we started, and we had a chat about what I wanted to achieve and why. So he knew my background. He knew what I was doing this for, and the level of support I've had has been surprising for me, if I'm honest. You know, he'll stay in touch, not just on days that we're training, but he'll contact me on any other day, really, just messaging, see how I am, see how I'm getting on, how am I feeling, how's your diet going, what you've been up to, just general chit chat, but very supportive, very motivational, and makes you feel great, and that definitely changed my life. And it's been a long road, but you know, I can see the difference in myself now. I've lost a lot of weight, I've gained some muscle, I'm eating right, I'm feeling more energetic than I've ever felt. I get up in the morning, some mornings, and I'm bouncing. Some mornings I'm not, some mornings I'm tired, but I can deal with it now. And that's, more than anything, that's what I feel like has changed for me. It's like, I'm still gonna have ups and downs in my life, like everybody does. But I feel like I'm in a position now where I can actually deal with it.
The thing is with my dad is that when people meet him, they love him. But what he needed to do was love himself, which I think he's done that now, and I couldn't be prouder.
I can still have days now where I'm not feeling 100%. But I kind of made a deal with myself a few months ago that negativity will no longer play a part in my life in any form. It has to be positivity, and you have to try and take the positives out of every situation that you're in. And that's what I did. So even on the days where I'm not feeling my best, I will find something positive and focus on that. Don't focus on the negatives. What's the point in that? Focus on the positives, nothing else. And I find it works for me, but I think by opening up to people and telling them how I was feeling, again, gained a lot of strength through that. But I think the single biggest thing for me was helping myself as well. You know, I look back to when it was all really going pear-shaped for me, and just towards the end of my relationship, she done absolutely everything she could to help me. ending the relationship was the last option. But it was an option that had to happen because I wasn't helping myself. So as much as she was trying, it had to come from me. It had to come from me, and I guess it didn't at the time because I took things for granted and I was still in a little bit of denial, and I knew I wasn't 100%. But it was too easy just to say, oh no, I'll be all right, I'll be all right. When actually I wasn't. So whilst I think one of the first things to help yourself is to open up to people, I also think helping yourself is the second thing. Because there's only so much others can do for you, but what they can do is give you the strength, the courage, and the motivation to then go and help yourself. And that's what I felt I got from personal training and counselling. They were the two biggest things that have helped me, health and fitness and counselling. The counselling come first, and it got me in a position where I felt able to put that step forward. The health and fitness has changed that step into a sprint. And I sprinted forward after that. I never looked back. And I guess all I can say is it's been a big long journey. It's been hard at times. It's been scary at times. But I kind of wouldn't change it, because although I've lost things that I didn't want to lose and I went through a bad time, I feel like I'm a much stronger person now than I ever was before. And I feel like maybe life just was meant to be like this for me. I was meant to go through that period in my life, because we're all made up of the experiences that we go through. And that was an experience that taught me a lot. It taught me that you can quickly lose things if you don't stay on top of it. You can quickly go downhill without actually realising it. And a mental illness, mental illness isn't something that you can see. It's a silent killer. Emphasis on the silent. And I'll never forget what I've been through. I'll never forget what I lost. But I'll never go back to the way I was, because I know now that life is there to be lived. You know, it's I know it's an old cliche, but life's so short that if we don't enjoy it now, it'll soon be over. And then what's the point? So you may as well enjoy it while you're here.
Well, that's the end of this part of my journey. It's been a long journey, plenty of ups and downs, big ones. It's been emotional, but it's been worth it. And I was worried about doing this and putting it out there, worried about what people are going to say, but fuck it, man. This was about me, about what I wanted to do. And you know, I look back to where I was 8, 9, 10 months ago, and I'm a different person. And I honestly didn't think it'd be possible. And with the help of others, Emma, Steve, Christine, Sean, I can't thank them enough, because their bravery in coming forward and telling their stories is more proof that no matter where you are, no matter what you're going through, you can get through it. You can get through it. Have faith. believe and trust people. Share your thoughts, share your feelings. Don't keep it in. You can get better. Things can get better. Don't give up, ever. And the thing about all the things I've tried, you know, from hypnotherapy to CBT, counselling, self-help, personal training, some worked, some didn't. But you've got to try them. Because one of them could work for you. And I've got to say a special thanks to Liam Sheridan, personal trainer at Transfit in Widnes. I don't know where I'd be if I hadn't gone to him. I don't think I'd be here right now. And you know, I set myself a lot of goals. Some I achieved, some I didn't. It's not about dwelling on what you didn't do. It's about being positive, thinking about what you have done, what you can do. And that's it, really. It's time to say goodbye. And I've been thinking about what to say and how to end it. Simple goodbye, maybe. Then it got me thinking. Got this poster in my bedroom, and it's of all of Nelson Mandela's most famous quotes. And one of them's really apt right now. And it says, "There's nothing quite like returning to a place that remains unchanged, to find ways in which you yourself have altered."